Hello and welcome to the news here on Magic Bricks, now India's first property business channel. I'm Krishna Kumar. Let's first take a look at all that's making headlines in the world of real estate. Another delay for Mumbai's development plan. The BMC gets 3 more months to submit the plan they got wrong in April 2015. That's a Magic Bricks Now exclusive. After home buyers and courts, private equity firms are up in arms against the builders. A Mumbai-based PE firm has filed a complaint against real estate company Terraform Realty for breach of trust, cheating and misappropriation of funds. The government announces the Startup India mission. We take a look at Startup Central Bengaluru and tell you how you as a home buyer can benefit from the startup boom. Straight up to our big story. Mumbai is a city without a plan, and it's likely to stay that way until June this year. The BMC, or the Brihan Mumbai Municipal Corporation, has received a third extension on its deadline to finalize the development plan that it got wrong in April 2015. My colleague Disha Shah gets us some exclusive details in this report. Take a look.
Mumbai will not have a plan in place for another 3 months. The development plan, which is essentially a blueprint on which the whole city is designed and developed for the next 20 years, which the BMC is working on, has got yet another extension, a third extension. And this is what the BMC Commissioner Ajoy Mehta has confirmed with Magic Bricks Now, that they have been granted a third extension by the state government. This means that we have to wait for the next fiscal for the new draft to be released, and that will happen only in the month of June this year. BMC officials say that they need some more time to rectify all the errors related to mapping of the existing land use, proposals related to densification, infrastructure and open spaces in this city. Just to give you a background, this is the third time that the civic body has been granted an extension. Earlier, they had got an extension in the month of September 2015 and the second extension in February. And now with the third extension, it clearly seems that the city is without a plan for at least 3 months from now.
So clearly the delay in submission of the plan is affecting builders in the city. For one, Oberoi Realty in their earnings con call said that even though they have received the commencement certificate for the land they acquired from GlaxoSmithKline, they will not construct until the new development plan is in place. And joining us to understand this better is another developer, Deepesh Salgia, director at Shapurji Palonji Group. Mr. Salgia, thank you so much for taking time out to be with us here on the news on Magic Bricks. Now tell us, how many projects have you as a developer kept on hold because of the delay in the DP?
We have actually not kept any projects
for the
DP. But I tell you, the issue is more related with the new projects that you plan to take, and or any builder plans to take, there the uncertainty increases because of non-clarity of rules. So either the developers are postponing the project, or because of the higher risk, there is an increase in cost, obviously, because risk is also part of a cost. So either way, it also affects the buyer because he has lesser options, and for the developer, the cost is also higher. So it does not help anyone. The delay does not actually help anyone.
Deepesh, that's what I wanted to check with you about. The BMC has been granted a third extension to get this DP right. Talk to us about how this affects construction as a whole in the city.
Yeah, of course, it does, because you cannot make decision on a gray area when the rules of the games are not defined. So you would like to take a decision when there's a clarity on rules. So then you have clarity on the sale area and your commitments to buyer, which is very critical now, because in the new real estate regulation, you have to very clearly specify the open spaces, the green areas to customers. And tomorrow the rules change, and then your plans change, then your customers are going to sue you. So you also have higher risk. So obviously you want to have all the clarity before you actually commence the design, construction or sale.
All right, Deepesh, before I let you go, one last question. Tell us, what are your expectations as far as the new DP for year 2034 for the city of Mumbai is concerned?
So I think the first thing is that the process is supposed to be very fast now. And there should be a commitment on the final date of delivery. I think that is more very, very important, actually. You know, let's say government makes, okay, by December 31st, 2016, it will be final. So you can actually plan for the next year. So I think the date of the final date, this final approval is important. And secondly, in terms of, reservations or whatever, DP road or whatever the issues are, there should be once in a while for a plan published in which, you know, there is no, there's no error in terms of drafting. Because what the law says, whether they publish DP or the actual DP, the worst of the two will apply. So that actually affects all the project because the worst of the two will apply. So there's an error. Even the error also applies to you, even if it's not, otherwise should have been applied to you. So I think the number of errors has significantly come down in the new DP, or should come to zero only in the new DP.
Deepesh Salge of Shahpur Jeepal ONG Group, thank you so much for taking time out to be with us here on the news on Magic Breaks Now. Moving on. The deadline for the Mada Konkan lottery is inching closer, and as always, the public housing body has already received more applications than the flats to be allotted. We have Ruchi Deshpande joining us on the phone line with more details on that. Ruchi, tell us how many applications have been received till date?
It's not even been a few days since this lottery was announced by the Konkan Board of Mada, and the applications have already exceeded the amount of flats to be allotted. Now, if we look at the statistics, the number of registrations has been more than 2,100, out of which about 4,000, almost 5,000 is the number of applications that has been received by Mada till date, and out of them, 920 people have made payments for the flats to Mada. Now, just to give you a recap of how many flats Mada's Konkan Board was allotting, we have 183 flats in Thane region of Mumbai. Similarly, we have 310 at Mira Road, which is in the western region of Mumbai, and the most here are 3,800 flats that are in Virar and about 27 flats in Vengurla, that is in Konkan. Also, to give you a little more detail, the cost of these flats under the Mada lottery for this year, that is 2016, starts from rupees 4.5 lakh and goes up to 40, almost a little more than 40 lakh. And if you talk about the size of these flats, they are about 368 square feet to about 670 square feet. Also, just to sum up, the Mada Lottery 2016 results will be released next month, that is on the 24th of February, and the registration for the same will end next month as well, that is on 7th of February. So we will keep you updated as to how many applicants get lucky in the lottery that Mada will allot.
Yes, we will, Ruchi. Keep an eye on all the lucky ones for the Mada lottery. Thank you so much for bringing us that update. Moving on to a story which you have been tracking right from day one here on Magic Breaks Now. As the probe on the late Suraj Parmar's suicide case continues, another builder, Amar Bhatia, one of the directors of Mohan Group, was found dead on the tracks between Ambernath and Badlapur railway stations on Sunday. Officials of the Kalyan Government Railway Police think it is a suicide, as they received information that Bhatia has sent SMSs to his relatives stating he was under depression and that he would end his life. However, the deceased family thinks it could be a murder. The police has begun conducting inquiries, and we on Magic Bricks Now will keep a close watch on this developing story. Shifting focus then, Bengaluru is set to get a connectivity boost, with BMRCL officials telling us that work on Metro Phase 2 is likely to begin in June this year. Remember, a couple of days ago, Magic Bricks Now brought you exclusive details on the civic body's land acquisition plans and the compensation charges for the second phase. We now learn that the estimated compensation charge for the second phase is 5,500 crore rupees, double of what the civic body had estimated. This escalation in costs comes due to a revision in land guidance values post-2015. Now, after home buyers and investors, private equity funds are taking legal recourse against developers. Mumbai-based PE company Urban Infrastructure has filed an FIR against Terraform Realty, or what was formerly known as the Everest Group. The PE firm alleges that it had invested 110 crore rupees in a special purpose vehicle with the developer. However, that money has not been accounted for. My colleague Aishwarya Paliwal gets us more details about the case. Aishwarya, tell us more.
In 2012, private equity player had actually gone to the EOW. They were said that, you know, they had made a special purpose vehicle with Everest Group. That time they were known as Everest Group. Currently they are known as Terraform Realty. They said that, you know, they had formed a special purpose vehicle for 110 crores. When they went through the EOW told them to go to the High Court. They went to the High Court. They got no relief from there. Then they went to the Supreme Court. Since they got no answers from both these places, they have now again filed an FIR with the Cuff Parade Police Station. They are saying that the 110 crores that they had put in this joint venture with Terraform Realty has been unaccounted for. They said they have been trying to get in touch with the realty, but there has been no response from it. Currently, Cuff Parade Police Station has been taking case of this investigation.
Aishwarya Paliwal there getting us the latest on that story, and we will be keeping a track of that as well. Thank you so much for that. Meanwhile, in Delhi, the High Court today adjourned a case where it had served a notice to 20 top developers and the Competition Commission of India. The notices came in response to a writ petition that alleged that these developers had formed a cartel and were indulging in unfair trade practices. The developers named in the petition include Amrapali, Unitech, BPTP, Gwarsons Tata Housing, Oberoi Realty and developer body CREDAI as well. The court also served a notice to the CCI. The High Court was hearing an appeal against CCI's judgment in the petition in 2011. The next hearing in this case is scheduled for the 12th of February. Oberoi Realty recorded consolidated revenues of 790 crore rupees for this quarter as against 219 crore rupees for the same quarter last fiscal. That's an increase of over 300%. The company also saw a 164% increase in consolidated net profit on a year-on-year basis. My colleague Aishwarya Paliwal is standing by with more details on Oberoi's numbers. Aishwarya, do the number crunching for us. Tell us more.
You know, Oberoi Realty sold close to 645 housing units just in the third quarter of FY16. Now, this the housing that they had sold costed them close to 117 crore. It got them 1700 crore rupees in their kitty. You know, most of this was from their newly launched project Sky City in Borivali. Just few months back, they had launched this project and they had sold. They have almost sold more than 70% of it. In the next month, you know, they'll launch another tower in the same project in the Sky City. They'll have another tower, and they are saying that they'll complete it in the next 6 months. And most of these units in this upcoming tower have already been sold. They are saying that, you know, they'll launch another tower in the project Enigma in Mulund. So they are saying another tower, they are constructing another tower because people are asking for it. This is what Vikas Oberoi said in a conference call that took place today. Also, you know, it could, in the next few months, they have some stellar projects coming up. They have already got the commencement certificate for the GlaxoSmithKline land that they had bought in Worli. But Vikas Oberoi said that, you know, he's waiting for the new development plan to come up. He's saying until unless clarifications are not made on the new development plan, he will not make up his mind as to what to do with the project. He's saying he could either make it a housing project or he could make it a retail project, but he'll only take a call once the development plan is in place. Also, he's saying that, you know, the company is looking at doing away with phase-wise construction. He says that, you know, he wants to complete constructions in one phase. Listen in to what he said during the conference call today.
We feel that there is demand as far as our this thing goes. Our own capacity to build has increased. We hire some of the best contractors in the world. And, you know, we just thought that as a company, we are now capable of delivering such large projects at one go. There's nothing other than that. So as a strategy, we would really like to go all out and build it, unless it's like a larger complex where we're doing different stuff, different things and stuff like that. But otherwise, we want to go at one go and finish it.
So, you know, looking at all that he's saying and the stellar projects that they have in Kitty, we can expect, you know, Oberoi Realty to do stellar in the next few quarters.
In the next few quarters is the word coming in from Aishwarya Paliwal. Thank you so much for that. But sticking to realty earnings then, LIC Housing Finance also came out with its third quarter numbers. The company's profits have risen to 420 crore rupees and the loan book has also increased to 1.17 lakh crore rupees. ET now caught up with Sunita Sharma, MD and CEO at LIC Housing Finance, and asked her about the disbursals the company has witnessed and whether the company was seeing an increase in home loans for affordable housing. Let's listen to what she had to say.
We have for the whole year a disbursement target around 33,000 crores and we should be able to complete that. At the moment, whatever oversupply is, it is of the premium segment. If the supply, which is actually, there's no supply of affordable housing. If the supply in the affordable housing segment starts, the demand, which is very high for affordable housing, will start getting met and that will definitely lift the economy.
Now, in the wake of the government's Startup India movement, we at Magic Bricks now tell you about how real estate will benefit from this move. Let's focus on Bengaluru, the startup hub of India. Then how many startups has the city attracted in the last 1 year? And what impact is this going to have on the city's commercial real estate market? Amita Balachandra gets us the details.
That's right. The government's Startup India push, of course, is not just going to open up more jobs in the country, but will also have an impact on the real estate market in India, especially in a city like Bengaluru, which is also the startup hub of India. Now, if you take a look at the numbers, it's very clear that in the last 1 year, Bangalore's startup market has expanded. Now, from 4,000, we have 9,000 startups, according to iSpirit Foundation. We also are seeing that Bangalore has attracted the most number of startups, especially because the numbers say that 41% of the total startups in India are seen in Bengaluru. Now, obviously, it's very evident that most of these startups are tech startups, and some of the emerging areas there are Whitefield, Outer Ring Road, Electronic City, and other areas in the peripheral Ring Road, especially because these are IT concentrated areas. But a couple of brokers in Bengaluru also tell us that the demand for office space still remains high in central Bengaluru, areas like MG Road, Infantry Road and Residency Road see high rentals. However, that is slightly changing. They tell us that demand is slightly shifting to the outskirts of city. When we look at office spaces itself, the demand for smaller office spaces when compared to large office spaces is comparatively lower, and that number is also likely to change with the government's push.
All right, then, to get us a better perspective on that, we are being joined in by Jaggi Marwa, MD, South India at JLL, to get us a perspective on the Bengaluru market, thanks to the startup boom. Jaggi, thank you so much for being with us here on the News and Magic Quick Snot. Let us, like Amita was just telling us over there, most of these startups are coming up in the areas surrounding the outer ring road and the peripheral ring road in Bengaluru. Tell us why you see this trend in the first place.
No, I think The true garage startups that have actually mushroomed in Bangalore, last count is about 2,500 odd startups registered in Bangalore, are all in the periphery of the Inner Ring Road, Koramangala, Indranagar, primarily because these are the areas where the upwardly mobile and the technology guys who actually lived in Bangalore, they are actually rooted in that area. So I think more to do with the ecosystem around Koramangala and Indranagar and the area surrounding that that's the primary reason why you see majority of the startups mushrooming up in the CBD in the CBD or the peripheral ring road of peripheral business district of Bangalore.
Also, Jaggi, I wanted to ask you this, what kind of demand are you looking at for small office spaces? Tell us, what kind of rentals do you see in these areas?
Quite clearly, I think there is a substantial demand from the e-commerce industry. And, we were looking at our statistics of at JLL. I think in Bangalore alone, we have seen a tremendous growth in terms of the e-commerce demand, and this doesn't include the smaller the smaller startups. It includes the larger e-commerce players. But having said that, thanks to the initiative of the government and the way they are actually propelling this entire initiative driven by the Prime Minister, I think we are on the cusp of a huge offshoot of demand that may hit the city, especially with regard to smaller office spaces, vis-a-vis 5 to 10 or maybe 5,000 square feet to 10,000 square feet, need of office space. Peripheral CBD areas, which is just the outer CBD circumference of the city, are in certain business parks, they're trading at about between 70 to 80 rupees, in certain business parks, around 100 rupees. So that's pretty much the, and when you take smaller spaces on lease, naturally the rents would be a little, a tad higher than the larger spaces.
Okay, Jaggi, tell us what kind of an appreciation do you expect going forward, especially with the government's push, and how much of an impact will this have on the residential market? Tell us that.
there won't be an immediate effect on the residential market as per se, but you know, with these, each of these startups mushrooming and they are growing substantially, once they start, you know, acquiring talent and acquiring the business that they are set out for, you will see over a period of time there will be a positive impact on residential, but not in the short term at all.
All right, Jaggi, we will let it go with that. Jaggi Marwa of JLL joining us here on the news for a better perspective on the Bengaluru market thanks to the Startup India push. Moving on. The interiors of a home are as important, if not more important, than the exteriors. And I'm sure that plenty of us love to dress our space to the best of our abilities. I'm sure plenty of us have old grills at home that mar the beauty of our pads. So if you'd like to learn how to make your old grills look more elegant, then here are some tips from interior designer Jannath from this week's episode of The Interior Show. Take a look.
Jannath, tell me that when we usually talk about grills, right, it's usually a very mundane element of the house. How do you look at it?
See, I draw a lot of my inspiration from origami.
Okay.
So definitely, yes, every room, say it has a particular theme. Mm-hmm. The grill will be designed according to that theme. But when I like to, when I say origami, I'm going to show you a couple of screens which I have with me, which okay. I've done. So if you see this screen and if you see the way it shuts and it opens,
yeah.
there are a lot of vertices that you see. So it creates this kind of a 3D effect.
Okay.
You can also just draw the wireframe out and use that into grills,
okay.
right? And it looks so pretty.
So these days, Jannath, in the new buildings that are coming up, I don't really see grills. So are they relevant in today's time or in the future?
See, grills are extremely relevant if they are a part of the building elevation and design. Anything to do with safety and security, you have to install a grill.
So how do you balance security and the aesthetic part of grills?
See, the security part of it remains intact because I need to see the distance between the sections that I'm creating. And definitely you can't actually pass through it.
Mm.
So that's very important. So every form that I design, that is the key element that
okay.
kind of drives my proportions.
So tell me something about the design of the grill. Sometimes, you know, the design is not too appealing and
right.
you can't really do much about
yeah.
it, especially in rented apartments. In
Correct.
That case, how do you deal with grills?
So if you already have grills installed, yes, I'd like to say that the easiest thing you can do is to give it a new look probably and make it look fresh. You paint it again.
Okay.
But yeah, if you're looking to give it a new form, you can just probably remove a certain portion, design that would be enough, and
okay.
then weld it back into the grill. That's the beauty of it.
And is that very easy to do?
That's very easy to do.
So tell me, how have you experimented with grills?
So in some of my projects that you've seen, actually we've done like a bird cage incorporated into
oh.
the grill. So you have this 2D
hmm.
and then you have a 3D actual circular
hmm.
bird cage, which is painted
okay.
in a different color. So that was something very different.
Now, we are running out of time here on the news. However, there's a quick reminder to all our viewers. BJP spokesperson Shaina NC had announced on the Urban Debate here on Magic Bricks Now that the government wants citizens to send in their suggestions and changes that they would like to see in the Maharashtra regulator. So if you or anyone you know wants to make any suggestion, then do send in your questions, queries and suggestions to feedback@mbnow.in, and we promise to send it across to the government.
It is India's landmark regulation and the government wants suggestions.
If there are any written appeals that come through UFE from your viewers, from people who are part of the housing fraternity, so I would request you, please do use me as a tool to reach out to make your voice heard.
Magic Bricks Now, the voice of Indian real estate.
And apart from that, if you have any other feedback or suggestions for us, write to us on the same email ID, feedback@mbnow.in. We're also on Twitter and Facebook, so feel free to tweet to us or post your query on our Facebook page. We would love to hear from you. Also, remember to check out our live streaming website, www.mbnow.in. And with that, it is a wrap on this edition of the news on Magic Bricks Now. Thank you so much for watching. This is Krishna Kumar signing off.